Chapter 3. 20th Century Miracle. The Sources of Spring Water in the World.
A dialogue between the great scholar Mohammad Amin Sheikho and the 20th century philosopher Sir John Godolphin Bennett. Let us now witness the depth of the knowledge of this honourable scholar, Mohammad Amin Sheikho, relating to the great scientific theory that is the 20th century miracle, the sources of spring water in the world. The following includes all the details of this discussion.
In the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful.
Dear reader, would you like to accompany us on a conceptual, sublime, and intellectual journey? Don't you want to add something new to your information that is a science and a truth which the humankind of the era of the atom and the moon landing cannot disclose, with all their appliances and electronic equipment? Would you like to be with us at the door of a puzzle which has astonished scientists, geographers, and researchers? A puzzle which bewildered them until one began to pray, saying, O God, where is the answer? This puzzle, which geographers, researchers, and scientists were unable to solve, is about the source of the water which you and I drink, and without which there is no life. What is the source of this water? Where does it come from? How? Let us go together and investigate where this fresh water comes from. Who sends it to us and how? Now that science has overtaken us and civilization has invaded us, it is better to leave the noise and the smoke of the factories and the cars and go on a journey in the ship of the mind to investigate the truth about the South and North Poles, the farthest boundaries of our world. It is an interesting and exciting journey, filled with exciting landscapes, dazzling whiteness, and many attractions created by the Almighty God. And nothing disturbs this region except a severe cold.
The North Pole is an area of more than 14 million square kilometers. This is more than 65 times greater than the area of Syria. Vast areas of the region are glacial mountains, ice, and glacial deserts. Who has created this wonderful landscape? Are you longing to know how these snows were formed? Where did they come from? Under what circumstances were they formed? And who is behind all this? Were they formed by themselves? Have the East or the West formed them with all their science and civilization? Is there not a merciful hand that takes care of you and me, that has created all this? Is there any movement without a moving hand? Can we not say to the scientists of this world and civilization, where is your science? Where is your civilization? Answer us before you invade space and make mass destructive weapons to kill the innocent and humiliate the weak. Answer us and tell us where this water, which our life and yours depend on, comes from, before you think and feel proud of your sciences which destroy mankind. Has God created you for destruction and demolition, or to fill this world with justice, mercy, tolerance, sympathy, humanity, and kindness?
Let us, my dear brothers, continue our journey to the North Pole, where there are snows, glacial mountains and deserts, and where we find severe cold and strong storms. The sun's rays are inclined to the north and south poles in such a way as to give off little heat. It is very cold, and the temperature sometimes goes down to 85 degrees centigrade below zero. Generally, snow falls and there are strong winds and severe glacial storms that make visibility almost zero. Life is very difficult and almost impossible. The day and night can last for months because of the inclination of the axis of the Earth. The sun does not set in the polar summer period. The sun can even be seen at midnight, and when it is summer on one pole, it is winter on the other. Because there is no sun, darkness prevails in the morning and in the evening for a few months. The Antarctic is colder and has a wider area of ice and snow. The speed of the winds is around 350 kilometers per hour. The average temperature in the Antarctic is a few degrees lower than it is in the Arctic pole. Winter is severe and merciless. Many have tried to explore the Antarctic, but they failed. The Antarctic, the frozen continent, is a waste continent in which snows reach 5,000 meters high. All these conditions, the dim light, the severe cold, and the strong storms, formed these snows and snowy mountains. Snow continues to fall day and night all the year round. What does all this mean?
It means that in the course of tens and hundreds of years, great amounts of snow will accumulate until they reach great heights, which exceed thousands of meters across the polar area. We all know that the two Earth poles constitute two such vast areas that one of them is considered to be one of the seven continents of the world. In the course of several years, it would seem that the two polar areas will dominate the other continents and change them into one snowy block. And consequently, there will be no life. Why does this not happen? Why don't the polar areas increase in height and area? Why have they kept their level without exceeding it for thousands of years? There is a continuous fall of snow and no increase in the size of the poles. Why? Where does this falling snow go? Where does it hide? And how? No one in the world, neither genius scientist, nor researcher, nor ordinary man can disclose the secret of the fate of these snows. Is this reasonable? Yes, it is.
Dear reader, if you lose precious jewels, is it possible that they could have disappeared by themselves, or has someone taken them? Then we realize that there is a hand which must have moved them. What hand has made and fashioned those mountains and glaciers? Oh, scientists, geographers, whether Eastern or Western, or researchers, explorers, do you have an answer for us? How do these vast plains that cover an area of thousands of square kilometers of ice move? What is the power which moves them? What is it like? Is it mechanical or hydraulic, propellant, sucking, or centrifugal? What a great, astonishing power it is that moves them. All the polar area drifts in its great vastness and volume.
The Norwegian scientist Nansen, in the 19th century, proved the existence of this drift. This man went to the North Pole on board the ship Fram, which was detained in the ice there at the end of the 19th century. Nansen wanted to prove to the world that the polar ice drifts slowly across the North Pole ocean. This was evidenced to him when his ship Fram left the ice on the other side of the frozen ocean in 1896, although it was blocked by ice in 1893. This proved that the whole pole area drifts. How does this vast area drift? Who makes it drift? Why and what for? Does that happen in play, capriciously, or by accident? In the Holy Quran, in Fortress 44, Ad-Dukhan, Smoke, verse 38, God says, "We created not the heavens, the earth, and all between them for mere amusement."
Let us study the books of science so that we may understand. Let us go to Greenland. Natural scientist Franklin Russell wrote a scientific report about an amazing scientific phenomenon. Along with other Eastern and Western scientists, he noticed that in an area of the North Pole, near Greenland Island, 8,000 icebergs are formed yearly, as shown by computer evidence. God says in the Holy Quran, Fortress 35, Fatir, Originator, verse 27, "And in the mountains are streaks of white and red, of diverse hues and pitchy black. They are moved by winds and storms. 5,000 of these icebergs reach Melville Bay." Human science was unable to describe how 3,000 icebergs disappeared into the unknown under cover of fog and the dark winter atmosphere.
Where do these icebergs vanish? What is the explanation for the disappearance of 3,000 icebergs? The scientists could not find an answer. Do you want to know the answer? Don't you want to know the source of your drinking water? The source of the springs from which you drink? This water is sent to you without change from the all-merciful, almighty God. Where does this ice go, whose diameter exceeds 4,000 kilometers, if there are no drains or ways out? Shouldn't it cover the earth? Shouldn't it put an end to life? Does nature think? Does it arrange its own affairs? Does it evaporate the seawater or make the plants grow? Does it make rain and snow fall at certain times? What is this nature and who made it?
Dear reader, we were in Greenland among the mountains, the ice and the snow, and we felt cold. We are now in need of the warmth of our country's sun. Let us go to Lebanon and to the high Besheri mountain, where there are tens of water springs at about 3,000 metres above sea level. The mountain is surrounded by the sea on one side and by hills and areas that spread across thousands of kilometres, which are lower than this mountain. Water definitely cannot ascend to high places. Who feeds these springs? From where do they ascend into these mountains? We do not exaggerate when we say that the human being who tried to solve this problem and gave it an answer which produced a great scientific theory really is a great man.
Let us also go to Jaita Cave in Lebanon, where there are stalagmites and stalactites. It is a lake in a high mountain, and on it boats run. How are such lakes formed when what surrounds them is lower than them? And water does not ascend from a low place to a high place, and there is nothing that feeds them. Let us then come back to our Greenland, Damascus, the land of forefathers and the place of prophets, to the spring of Al-Fijah, where there is that abundant cold water spring. Because of its coldness and clarity, you cannot keep your hand in its water for more than a few seconds. From which refrigerator does it come? It is from the Almighty's refrigerators. It is from the North Pole, which is more than 14 million kilometers away. How does it come to us? How can we say that it's from the pole? What is the proof of this? This is Al-Fijah spring, which supplies the inhabitants of Damascus, the capital of Syria. From where does it take its coldness? If the coldness was from the rains, the water would not be that cold. Additionally, when water goes down into the earth, its temperature goes up 1 degree for every 100 meters of depth. These springs come to us from places which may be thousands of meters deep. Where do these cold springs come from? And how do they exist in high places and on mountaintops without being fed by any tributary?
It is obvious that the polar snow always falls because it comes from clouds fed by the evaporated waters of the seas. Sun rays pour from the sun and penetrate the waters of the seas and oceans of the world, sucking up some of their water in the form of small invisible drops of water vapor, which are then driven by the wind to form clouds, which later fall as rain and snow. This means that the seas lose huge quantities of their waters every year. These waters do not return again to the seas, but accumulate as ice at the poles. It seems that in the decades to come, the oceans and seas will be dry. Why has this not taken place? Have we seen sea withdrawal from the shores of Tartus or Latakia in northwest Syria? How can we solve this mystery? And has the 20th century's civilization solved it? Is it true that rainwater feeds all the springs and rivers? These questions were answered by the great scholar Mohammad Amin Sheikho, who has derived his knowledge and science directly from God. He asked Sir Baynes, who was a scientist in natural science,
"Do you scientists from east and west know the source of the water you drink and from where your springs are provided with water?"
"Rainwater is the main source of drinking water."
"Rainwater is for the plants and animals. God says in the Holy Quran, verses 20, Taha, pure, verse 53 to 54, He let water fall from the sky. We thereby grew pairs of variable plants. Eat and graze your cattle. Meanwhile, God made a different arrangement for human beings who were honored by Him. What then is this arrangement? God says in the Holy Quran, verses 20, Taha, pure, verse 53, He who made the earth the cradle for you and made underground ways of water for you. Can you tell me, Sir John, is there a big river in Britain?
Of course, the Thames River, and big ships sail on it.
And is the quantity of rainwater that falls on Britain enough to feed that river all the year round?
Sir Baynes made some calculations according to the flow of the Thames and found cubic metres per second times 3,600 per hour times 24 hours per day times 365 days per year. He calculated the average rainfall in Britain and found that the rainwater falling on Britain would feed the river for only 1 week. Here our great scholar asked him another question.
From where does the River Thames feed during the remaining 51 weeks of the year?
When Sir Baynes could not reply, our scholar said,
From the waters of the snow, glaciers and ice of the pole.
How does this happen?
You know, Sir John, that it snows in the polar area almost throughout the year, and that the sun's rays are very dim and ineffective, like the light of the moon. If this ice and these icebergs had no drains or wide apertures at the bottom of the frozen ocean, ice would accumulate to a great height, and life would be impossible. There is great pressure from the ice and icebergs on some parts of the bottom of the icy ocean. The average depth of the North Pole is more than 3,000 meters, and the depth in the Antarctic is similar. It is scientifically known that when we go 100 meters under the ground, the temperature increases by 1 degree centigrade. But the spring waters come to us cold, fresh and pure, even though they come from under the ground, and from great depths that might reach thousands of meters. According to the laws of science, these waters should be hot when they reach us, because they should get heat from underground. But this does not happen. The great pressures of the icebergs on the huge apertures, or drains, on the ocean floor make the ice near the holes melt, and the water goes rapidly down these hot passages.
In the middle of the last century, an expedition led by the ship Ostrikane went to the high latitudes, where one of its units, headed by Jackal and Temifebev, specialists in the science of hydrology, travelled in the direction of Wrangel Island, 1 mile distant from the North Pole. Soon, when this unit reached a certain point, its members fathomed the depth of the ocean, and then they repeated this fathoming at the same point a short time later. They then discovered that the ocean floor had become about 400 metres higher than at the time of the first measurement. These fathoming operations to measure the depth of the ocean were performed successively, but the measurements continued to produce different and contradictory results. At that time, and even afterwards, the scientists failed to understand the secret behind these changes in depth. In fact, the contradictions in the measurement of the depth of the ocean, despite having been taken at the same point and at around the same time, proved and demonstrated that there is an interior drainage in the ice inside the ocean.
Heat in the interior of the Earth at the north and south poles helps the ice to melt and spout rapidly. After it melts, it branches off to feed all the springs and rivers on the surface of the Earth. Its fast, continuous flow through these passages keeps the water cold, and the high level of the poles above the ground, in addition to the axial inclination of the globe and its daily and yearly rotation, explain to us the ascent of water to the top of the mountains in the world, which sometimes are more than 3,000 meters high. Some of these springs come directly from the pole to the spring, which explains their coldness. Some springs are less cold because their passages feed reservoirs in the mountains, which in turn feed springs that are not so cold.
Today, it is noticeable that the global problem of the diminution of the groundwater and river dryness in many areas is associated with the waning of ice in the two poles, which results from heat retention. No doubt, this indicates the connection and the relation between the polar ice and all the rivers of the world.
This is truly amazing information for me. I had no idea that the poles had such a direct importance in our lives. I had really never thought about where the water of our rivers came from. I had always supposed that rainwater was what mainly fed the Thames and the other big rivers of my country and around the world. But what you say makes sense. It is also interesting to hear your explanation of why spring water is cold. But tell me, O scholar, where did you get this information? Are there any verses in the Quran that explain this phenomenon?
God says in the Holy Quran, verse 21, Al-Anbiya, the Prophets, verse 31, "We set in the earth firm mountains, lest it should shake with them. And we set in it ravines to serve as ways, so that they might be guided." We set in the earth firm mountains. We made the earth firm with mountains, lest it should shake, so that its rotation does not deviate and its surface doesn't crack. We made in it ravines. This refers to water reservoirs in the mountains, which release water according to strict scales. Isn't this evidence of Allah's existence? Ways, that is, springs. Big springs form the rivers, while small ones form springs. Who made their underground ways? So that they might, if they reflect, be guided to Allah Himself and to know Him. If you don't reflect, you will never be guided. These springs and rivers keep flowing because they are permanently fed by the north and south poles through these passages and those large lakes lying beneath the South Pole. They come to us at regular fixed levels all the year long. For certain very short periods of time at the end of winter and the coming of spring, the water level in the rivers gets high.
Why does this happen?
This is because they are fed by rainwater, and there is an increase due to the melting of the ice in the spring season, and this increase flows through the supplying reservoirs. After this, the river goes back to its normal, year-round level. From what has been explained above, we can see that there is a wonderful balance set by the merciful God to control all these things, without any contradictions among these natural laws. There is continuous flow from the springs and rivers, which is met by a continuous accumulation of snow all the year long, within very accurate criteria. And human science was not able to disclose its secrets.
Recently, the scientists of the 21st century discovered that there are lakes buried under Antarctica's layers of ice that connect to each other through rivers that move beneath the surface. but they could not ascertain that those lakes supply the rivers all over the world. Professor Martin Sigert of Bristol University says, "We often thought of the under-ice lakes to be separated and distinguished from one another." Furthermore, in the past, the common belief was that because of the severely cold weather in frozen Antarctica, there was no possibility of finding liquid water underneath the layers of ice. However, since the 60s, artificial satellites and planes supplied with accurate radar sets have begun to find increasing numbers of these lakes situated many kilometers deep beneath the ice. More than 150 of these lakes have been discovered until now, and scientists expect to discover many thousands more of them. The scientists believe that from time to time, great amounts of water pass from one lake to another through underground rivers because of increases in pressure. Some of these rivers have dimensions equal to the dimensions of the Thames River in London. The scientists affirmed that the lakes buried under Antarctica's layers of ice are connected with each other through rivers that move the water between these lakes under the surface. According to research published in the scientific magazine Nature, scientists see the need for a review of previous plans to perform explorative excavation operations in the layers of ice in this region. The supervisor of the research, Dangan Wingham, said, "The excavation there may cause pollution to all that underground water net with its own drainage system. This indicates that until the present day, they still know nothing about the function of these large lakes lying beneath the South Pole."
How great these polar reservoirs are! Who maintains and reforms them yearly for us and for our sake, so that we might enjoy them and be honored? What merciful and lending hand supervises all this providence? This is part of his permanent generosity and outpouring of love and compassion. It is all for our sake, yet we do not know about it. God says in the Holy Quran, verses 15, Al-Hijr, stone buildings, verse 22. "And we sent forth winds carrying the clouds, then sent down water from the sky, and gave it to you to drink, and you are not able to store it."
Do you reserve it? If it rains in winter, whatever reservoirs you maintain, what do you do in summer? Have you thought of the springs and the quantity of water which flows from them all year long? Have you not given a thought to their reservoirs? Who has organized them? Where are their locations? Don't they ever finish and reach an end? Think of that in order to achieve true faith.
This information is very new and very surprising for me. I wonder how it is that this question has never crossed my mind before. Please give me more of this knowledge. Do you have any more details about the passage of the water from the poles to the springs around the world? What about the seas and oceans? Do they play any role in this great movement of water across the face of the world?
God says in the Holy Quran, verses 39, Az-Zumar, the groups, verse 21. "Have you not seen that Allah sent down water from the sky, then made it penetrate into the earth and gush forth in the form of springs?" This holy verse proves that God sends these polar waters through passages under the ground. Sweeping currents go under the sea waters, and the one called the North Atlantic Drift, which goes in the northeastern direction after leaving the American coast, has a speed of between 5 and 6 knots and does not occur at the level of the waters near the surface. It has no effect at about 350 meters in depth. Researchers also found another great current called the Gulf Stream, which goes in the opposite direction. The currents with clear limits are called the Gulf Stream. The surface currents of the world go clockwise in the northern hemisphere, while they go in the opposite direction in the southern hemisphere and are called whirlpools. In the northern hemisphere, there are two severe whirlpools in the north of the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans, And in the southern hemisphere, there are three whirlpools going in the opposite direction, in the south of the Pacific and Indian Oceans. Underwater, there are currents whose direction may be the opposite of the salty surface currents. These currents across the sea, beneath the salty water, are made of fresh water.
In recent times, some Chinese scientists and geologists were able to discover a layer of fresh water on the seabed near the coast of Cheshang province, which is located in the east of China. This discovery boosted the scientists' hopes of finding more sources of drinkable water in the depths of the seas and oceans. These layers were found 300 meters below sea level, according to a scientific schedule aspiring to discover the source of the fresh water. About 20 geologists engaged in this search, the cost of which came to more than 20 million Chinese yuan. That is about $2.74 million. The head of this geological team said, "The first layer which contains the water may give at least about 10,000 cubic meters of drinkable water daily. But the big source is placed in the third layer, whose daily provision reaches 80,000 cubic meters."
God the Almighty mentioned these sea currents of fresh, cold water beneath the salty waters of the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans in the Holy Quran. In the verse of An-Nur, light, which attests to our argument, God says, in verse 40, "Or as darkness on a vast abysmal sea, there covered him a wave, above which is a wave, above which is a cloud, layer upon layer of darkness." Allah talks about the reality of this blind, deviant man, whose mind's eye was not open, and who remained blind. At the doors of death, he looked at his deeds and felt ashamed of them. They turned out to be darkness, and the darkness was like veils, which were exactly like this very deep sea. This holy verse is one example, like others that are mentioned in the Holy Quran. These examples are realities that exist in this life, such as this holy verse from Fortress 36, Yasin, safe and pure, verse 13. "Give them an example, the town's inhabitants, when God's messengers were sent to them. It is beyond doubt that there was a town to which God's messengers were sent." Another holy verse reads from the Holy Quran, Fortress 2, Al-Baqarah, the cow, verse 17. "They are like him who lit a fire." And the verse from the Holy Quran, Fortress 18, Al-Kahf, the cave, verse 32. "Give them an example. Two men. We gave one of them two orchards." This verse applies to what takes place in the north and south of the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans, which are the biggest and deepest oceans. There are many other examples like these in the Holy Quran. God mentioned the depths of darkness, which means very deep. There is no doubt that this is the deepest of the oceans and seas, since it is known that water, and especially salty, wavy water, reflects sunlight. The deeper one goes, the darker it becomes. The second reference, "overwhelmed with billow, topped with billow," indicates two waves, and undoubtedly they differ from each other. The upper waves are the waves of the salt water, while the lower, which flows fast, is cold and fresh. The dark clouds reflect back, and therefore hide the sunlight. And the salt water and the sweeping or lower cold water hides the fresh cold water underneath it. This increases the darkness.
Can you give me specific information and examples in relation to the biggest and most well-known bodies of water and rivers of the world?
Under the Gulf Stream, which goes northeast along the eastern section of the USA, there is a big cold current of fresh water flowing southwards in the north of the Atlantic Ocean from the North Pole area. The Gulf Stream divides into two branches. The first, going along the east coast of Greenland and northern and southern Europe, and the other going southwards to continue its whirlpool in the northern half of the Earth. Surface cold currents usually go to the south. In the southern hemisphere, cold water runs around the polar area, while branches go north towards the tropical and semi-tropical areas. This explains the flow of the Nile and Orontes rivers to us and the flow of others that travel in an opposite direction to the other rivers. This is quite clear in Syria, because the name of Orontes in Arabic means rebellious. This means that the sources of the springs and river waters partly come from the ice of the north and south poles. The rivers which flow from north to south come from the North Pole ice, and rivers of the opposite direction that flow from south to north come from the ice of the South Pole. Examples include the Orontes and the Nile. When these deep currents go across the seas from the poles under deep layers of swift salt water, they pass without mixing and at the same time go to the places of their second spring to become rivers, lakes and springs, without mixing with the upper and surface warm salt water. Springs of fresh water even exist in the deep areas in the Mediterranean and near the Greek coast of Corniche, and in the Atlantic Ocean, on the coast of Morocco, near Agadir, and in the Florida Peninsula. In Irrawaddy Island and the area of Latakia in Syria, fresh water comes from the bottom of the sea, because it is lighter in density and in weight than the salty water with which it does not mix. It goes up to the surface. The sailors and fishermen use this water to increase their supply of fresh water.
Again, you offer me remarkable information that is entirely new and amazing. Please give me as much additional information as you can about this topic.
God says in the Holy Quran, Fortress 25, Al-Furqan, the Criterion, verse 53. It is He who has let free two bodies of flowing water, one palatable and sweet, and the other salt and bitter. Yet He has made a barrier between them, a partition that is not to be passed. 1. In very deep seas and lakes, the sea's salt water is at the top, while the fresh water is below, and between them there is a solid partition, which is made up of the soil and the rocks of the crust, such as on Irrawaddy Island, which is surrounded by the salty waters of the sea. Springs and wells of fresh water spring from under the sea, and Almighty God made a partition between them. The fresh water does not mix with the salt water. It travels from the interior of the earth beneath the salty sea. The partition is the ground of the sea floor. It is a solid barrier of which the verse says, He has made a barrier between them, a partition that is not to be passed. In the mountains surrounding the seas, in the seas, and in their interior, the partition is made of rocks and earth, i.e., it is solid. So is it with the islands in the saltwater seas with fresh waters beneath. Two. The Gulf and Labrador currents, in addition to freshwater currents, have watery liquid partitions. It is He who has let free two bodies of flowing water, one palatable and sweet, and the other salt and bitter. 3. In the Arctic there are icebergs and fresh snows in the salty seas, and a partition is made from water. 4. In Antarctica, you find icebergs and fresh snows surrounded by saltwater seas. The partition is solid, consisting of rocks. It is a solid barrier, and a partition that is not to be passed. It is a barrier to prevent the waters from mixing and joining. They are barred from doing so by rocks. Saltwater seas surround Antarctica, and fresh water goes through passages below ground and then flows through passages under the sea floor to form big rivers and small springs on other islands, in villages, and elsewhere. It is known that the deserts contain vast layers of water underneath. In the Grand Desert, which is considered to be the largest desert in the world, which has an area greater than the area of Europe, there is a basin underground containing more than 12,000 cubic kilometers of water. This is 40 times bigger than the capacity of the Azuf Sea. From where does this basin take its water? Is it, as they say, from the rainwater that falls on the coasts of the Mediterranean, although it is 40 times bigger than the Azuf Sea? There is no doubt that it takes its water from one of the polar continents. In the north of Russia, the layers rich in water include the artesian exits in Kara, Qum, and Kazil Qum, and in other deserts. One of the largest artesian basins in the world is located in the west of Siberia, between the Urals to the west and the Yenisei River to the east. The area of this basin is more than 3 million square kilometers. Other of the largest artesian basins also exist on the European side of the Soviet Union. For example, the Moscow and Dnepro-Donetsk basins and others. The fresh water of these huge basins cannot be logically said to be from rainfall, but certainly must come from the adjacent North Polar area.
You are indeed a great and wise scholar. At first the notion seemed incredible, the idea that the North and South Poles are the source of the world's spring water, and that great reservoirs exist that feed our rivers that are fed by this frozen water from the poles. But your explanation of the phenomenon sounds entirely plausible and logical. Furthermore, you are able to talk about the subject in detail and have specific knowledge that can only have come from great insight. I want to thank you again for all your guidance on this and other matters. I now have a whole new understanding of the importance of these frozen wastes in sustaining humankind through the provision of the very basis of our existence, fresh water. Who would have thought that the ice and snow of the North and South Poles would provide us with the sources of spring water in the world?
These unique scientific explanations and miraculous mental journeys astonished Sir John Bennett and increased his love for and belief in God.
We can conclude that the polar areas are big reservoirs of water from which we take our cold, pure drinking water. The mountains are but reservoirs. The spring openings are of changeless fixed quantities of water all the year round, and the rain and snow that fall serve only for the irrigation of our plants and animals. However, man is honored by God, so he drinks from the pure raging water of the polar areas. Look how much God favors us over all other creatures. In the Holy Quran, verse 100, Al-Adiyat, the blowy wind, verse 4 to 5, God says, "We transferred and maintained it by immersion." In Arabic, Atharna means transferred and maintained. The last letter in Arabic, which is N, denotes the supreme merits of Almighty Allah. That is, his supreme names, containing mercy, charity, kindness, and compassion, in addition to other perfect merits. The phrase "by it" denotes the discipline that led to rainfall. Immersion refers to the gathering water. The words "we made it in a medium location for all the living creation" include the word wasatna in Arabic. And this phrase means that it was made in a medium location. The last letter in Arabic, N, denotes the supreme merits of Almighty Allah. By it refers to the accumulating water. We can interpret this verse as follows. God speaks about moving and maintaining the water through his mercy, kindness, love and affection, and shows that there is a system through which the rain falls, gathers together, and makes the huge polar supply. He tells his creation that out of his kindness, love and affection, he carries the rainwater and keeps it in these huge reservoirs in the polar areas. He carries that collected water through certain passages that run beneath the ground and in appropriate proportions, which bring the springs and rivers into existence for our own good. Who maintains, cleans and reforms all these drains and underground passages that carry these polar waters? How are these polar waters let travel to every island, city and village, all over the world in regular proportions, all year round, for our own use? None steers and provides for the universe but you, out of your extreme favor and abundant generosity, O Allah.
May God reward you, our great scholar, with all love, honor, respect, and reverence. You really deserve to be honored for your love for God and your omniscience from God. May God lead us to it by His great favor. He is very near and responds to the prayer that allows Him to communicate with you. Allah says in the Holy Quran, Fortress 2, Al-Baqarah, the cow, verse 282, be under Allah's light, and then it is Allah that teaches you. True praise is to you, provider of all the worlds.